For those who need a Satansplaining of the LaVey synthesizer clock, keep listening, because today on Satansplain we'll dive into Anton LaVey's definitive go-to book on lesser magic, The Satanic Witch.
Well, it's not Satan worship, it's Satanism. It's embracing the life-enriching things which have traditionally been given the devil's name. Pride, lust, earthly success, rational self-interest, atheism, humor, nonconformity, science, a passion for living, being selective about whom we love. We don't see these as shameful sins, but empowering ideals. And we also recognize the psychological power and fun of symbolism and aesthetics, so we utilize Satan as mythology's most fitting mascot for what we're about.
Satansplain. Satanic talk with Church of Satan Magister Bill M.
Magister Bill M. here with Satansplain. Those of you who've read the Satanic Bible by Anton LaVey know that two of the many conceptual tools mentioned in that book are lesser magic and greater magic. LaVey then expanded on the concept of greater magic with the supplemental book, The Satanic Rituals. But as far as lesser magic, it was back in 1971 that Anton LaVey published The Complete Witch, subtitled Or What to Do When Virtue Fails. This book was then reissued in 1989 by a new publisher under its more familiar title, The Satanic Witch. A couple of weeks ago, somebody asked me if I could do a Satansplain segment or episode to talk more about The Satanic Witch, specifically the LaVey synthesizer clock, which takes up a significant part of the book. And I immediately thought back to a discussion slash interview I did back in 2016 where I talked about that in some detail. So I figured, what the hell, why not include that recording in an episode of Satansplain? So that is what you'll be hearing this time. I have several things to say about this episode, though, before we begin. First, I had some trouble trying to track down the recording itself. The show that I was a guest on was called Dark Voices. It was a radio-free Satan show, and like I said, it was around the year 2016. They only made about 10 episodes, I think. But that same host also hosted another show on Radio Free Satan at the time called Dark Whispers. And on Dark Whispers, she played a lot of electronic and ambient music that she mixed herself. Dark Voices, however, was her talk show, and a number of different Church of Satan members were interviewed to talk on different topics. The talk about the Satanic Witch spanned four parts with four different Satanists. So what you'll hear is the last of those four, which was the one with me, where we talk about the Satanic Witch and related topics. Now, like I said, I had trouble trying to find this recording. I could not find the interview, that episode anywhere online. So I dropped a line to the owner of Radio Free Satan, Magister Gene, and he was able to dig up a copy for me. So thanks again to Magister Gene. You can check out his show, his podcast on RadioFreeSatan.com. His show is called Vox Satani, a wonderful classical music show. Definitely check that out if you haven't yet on RadioFreeSatan.com. But I did also get in touch with Vesper Val, and I wanted to get her permission to re-air this episode she had created, and she said yes. So in appreciation for her, I would like to plug her SoundCloud channel. She is still doing music under the name Vesper Valen. SoundCloud.com/VesperValen. Hopefully I'm pronouncing that right. VesperValen. I'll try to include the link in the description of this Satansplain episode. And now three more quick things before we listen to that. First of all, this recording starts with some basic interview questions. And at that time in 2016, the Dr. Vincent Schitz page was relatively new. Only about 1,000 likes at the time. And it has since grown to, I think, around 14 or 15,000 it is today. I still run that. The original owner left the page with me. And since then, you know, I've been running it, but with the help of one or two others. Someday we'll get around talking all things Dr. Schitz here on Satansplain, but not today. Today it's all about The Satanic Witch, a book which I've seen a number of Satanists over the years ignore, or read it once and not really apply any of it, or read it and not really understand it. I've seen some male Satanists in particular stupidly dismiss the book as something only women can benefit from, or said they would wait until somebody finally wrote The Satanic Warlock, all points of which I address in this episode. And that brings me to the second of the three things I wanted to point out. This episode, as you'll hear, was recorded before the book The Satanic Warlock was finally written and released by Magister Bob Johnson. So we talk about the anticipation of the book at that time. My own thought at the time was, oh, geez, we don't need the Satanic Warlock, because if a warlock can't get anything out of the Satanic Witch, then a book called The Satanic Warlock probably isn't going to help them. But then I heard that Bob Johnson was the one going to write it, and I thought, oh, well, okay, then if it's him, if it's that guy, the guy who gave us Old Nick magazine and then some, then sure, this could be interesting. Better that the book is going to be written by him, somebody qualified, and not, you know, some random schmuck who doesn't understand the Satanic Witch. And finally, the third thing I want to mention, Dark Voices was a show that was purposely produced with certain sound effects and ambient noise. So you'll hear some background music, you'll hear voices switching between the left and right channels, you'll hear different EQ and reverb effects on my voice. So that's all done on purpose. That was all in the original recording, done by Dark Voices, not by me. The host of Dark Voices suggests that you listen with headphones to get the full effect. Personally, I like it. It's kind of hypnotic. And with that, from 2016, here is the long-lost episode number 6 of the long-lost Radio Free Satan show, Dark Voices, where the host and I discuss, among other topics, the Satanic Witch.
Welcome to Dark Voices. In this episode, I interview Bill M. We break down the LaVey personality synthesizer clock in its simplest terms so that people can better understand it. We also talk about the three layers of personality. We talk about the chapter on ESP, extrasensual perception, and give a lot of thought to scent, and especially what that means to men. We also talk about men's fashion and grooming. Bill M. is a great interviewee. He's a lot of fun to talk to, hilarious, and an all-around personable person. It was a great interview, and I had a lot of fun conducting it. Please enjoy. Okay, who are you, and what do you do?
My name is Bill M., and a lot of listeners probably know me as the host of The Devil's Mischief on Radio Free Satan, which I believe is the longest-running satanic podcast. But when I'm not doing that comedy show, I'm involved in comedy in some other ways, running georgecarlin.net, and doing most of the work these days on Dr. Vincent Schitz, that page on Facebook, as well as my group there, Ridicule of Shitty Writing, also a YouTube channel. I'm a musician. I do a lot of contract work by day as an engineer, and also just submitted artwork for The Devil's Reign 2.
Do you own the Dr. Schitz page, or is that just something you help out with?
That is something I help out with. The person who created it, he wishes to be anonymous, but he was looking for other admins, and so I contacted him, gave him my list of satanic comedy credentials, which I certainly have some, I think.
I would say so.
And yeah, he liked it, he accepted it, and we've just been growing the site from there. Started off really small, and now we're close to 1,000 likes, and it's given me a different outlet for comedy that I don't get from, the podcast format.
I'd say you're doing a fantastic job. I really like those memes because they're close to actual Church of Satan members, and it's something that actual Church of Satan members can relate to.
Yeah, I mean, when he created the page, he sort of made it pretty clear, and it's clear in, like, the About section and stuff, that this was a page that was meant to really sort of appeal to Satanists and get into the actual sort of inside jokes that Satanists would understand, instead of just some of these other satanic meme pages that pretty much focus all the attention on first phase sort of stuff, blasphemy and religious bashing. And I like religious bashing as much as the next Satanist, but it can get old pretty fast. I think, you know, comedically, you can really take things to the next level, and I think that's what he did to this page, and so I've been happy to contribute.
I agree completely. What is your membership status in the Church of Satan, and can you discuss any of your administrative duties within the church, if any?
Sure. I am a magister of the Church of Satan, so that's degree 4. And I've done some media representation over the years, whether it was for, like, an online magazine, showing up in public situations, television. I'm also one of the admins for the unofficial group on Facebook, which has sort of become the public place for Church of Satan-related discussions. I also maintain some of the Ritter Free Satan-related pages. I've written articles over the years, some in print and some online. Some of those are on the official site. And I have performed satanic weddings and funerals as well before.
Oh, that's very cool. So getting into the Satanic Witch,
when would you say you first encountered it?
I first saw it in bookstores in the 1980s, and I had flipped through it as I, you know, this was during the whole satanic panic, so naturally, yeah, I was curious as to what some of these things were about. But just like the Satanic Bible, I knew about it, but I didn't really sit down and read it as an adult until years later, sometime in the 1990s. I had found the Satanic Bible and the Satanic Rituals, and then I think I bought the Satanic Witch third. In fact, I might have bought it the same day I bought Blanche Barton's Church of Satan, back when you could actually find that in a store and it was in print.
So by the time you read it, what other satanic literature had you read?
I had already read the Satanic Bible and the Satanic Ritual, so this was just another matter of getting, you know, getting another book, the LaVey arsenal. I might have also read The Devil's Notebook by that time too. I can't remember if I had read that before or after the Satanic Witch.
Satan Speaks by chance?
No, I know I didn't read that until later because I had already read all the books by the time before Satan Speaks had come out. And I remember when Satan Speaks came out.
As a warlock, how in general have you found the Satanic Witch useful?
Well, I think the real bulk of the book, a lot of it focuses on the synthesizer clock. So just the simple act of being able to size people up using that system. I've used that in just about every place, really. Job interviews, of course. Meeting other people that I wanted to impress or give certain impressions to, whether that's venue owners, as a musician, parents of women I've dated. And also tarot reading as well, because I have professionally done tarot reading and also numerology here in the Salem, Mass area.
Perfect. It's a perfect instruction manual for that. And have you made money? I mean, you said you did it professionally, so that implies you've made money doing it?
Yes, I have. Yes. I most certainly have.
That's
there's
awesome.
A lot, yeah. In Salem, Massachusetts, there's a big tourist crowd, especially around Halloween time. So I worked the psychic fair there for a number of years. A lot of people who are coming in like it for the novelty value of it, but then there are some other people who, you know, are specifically trying to seek it out and want some serious answers and so on.
Let's talk about the chapter entitled Knowing Yourself and Others. One of the most important chapters in the book, and many Satanist opinions, because it also tends to be the most confusing chapter for most. LaVey talks about breaking people down into three layers: the apparent, the demonic, and the core. Dr. LaVey says this about the layers: the outer layer being the cover, by which others often tell the book, and the inner, so-called true personality. The third personality represents the inner core, and is a direct reflection of the characterization which is seen on the surface, or first layer. The first two layers make perfect sense, but I think what confuses people is the core, or third layer. I think a lot of people wonder why it's there at all. Could you talk about that?
Well, the examples that they gave in the book seem pretty clear to me. They gave the extreme examples of a 6 o'clock man who has a female core, you know, a female 6 o'clock, because the bottom of the clock would be female. And likewise, there's the picture of the 12 o'clock woman who has the male core. I think it's really just like a testament to the fact that the image you portray on the outside is a manifestation of who you are on the inside, ultimately. And there are lots of personality tests that talk about this. But what seems to make it unique, though, LaVey's approach is the demonic layer, that in between, and working with that.
I think that's a very good way of explaining it. LaVey goes on to say that when dealing with people in general, you can tell a book by its cover and move on, but in the practice of witchery, you need to appeal to the demonic. What are your favorite tricks, clues, or cues in getting to that demonic self of someone you're trying to bewitch?
Well, I think like any good witch or warlock, I'm not going to reveal overly specific examples of my tricks of the trade. But I will say that it doesn't really take all that much. Sometimes just, you know, if you're trying to tune into that demonic, sometimes, you know, just a change in posture or a change in voice can go a long way. You don't necessarily have to change your whole wardrobe. But it's like sometimes just really simple cues, whether you're like wearing glasses or wearing contacts, wearing a hat, especially a baseball cap, something as simple as that can certainly send off, you know, the perceptions for better or worse.
Suit and tie versus...
Oh, yeah.
Okay. A lot of people also struggle with understanding the LaVey personality synthesizer clock. In your simplest terms, how would you break it down for them, and can you comment as to its usefulness?
Well, I'm glad you asked this question, because I've seen so many people over the years who don't understand it. And I've noticed that when people don't understand the whole clock system, it always seems to be one of two problems. And they're two of the opposite problems. They're both like extremes of each other. The first problem is there are people who oversimplify it, and the other extreme being there are people who overcomplicate it. I see people who oversimplify it by taking like one aspect from it and then trying to throw away the rest. I see guys who say like, oh, I hate people, so I must be a 12 o'clock man. Or likewise, would-be satanic witches, women who say, well, I like feminine things, so I must be a 6 o'clock woman. And more likely than not, no, you didn't give this a lot of thought.
Right.
You know, there's a reason why that whole section of the book is not just like 3 pages long. But again, like the other extreme is when people overcomplicate it. And I see people doing that a lot. And people are like, I don't understand. I have these 3 traits that fit a 7 o'clock and then these 2 traits that fit a 3 o'clock. It's like, back up here. The whole point of the system, I would say, is to give you a quick way to size somebody up. You know, at least enough to give you something to work with. Now, does every person on the planet neatly fit into a specific area of the clock? No, of course not. People are rarely going to fit, you know, completely. But does this mean we should just throw out the whole system and sit back and be like the New Agers and rationalize this with, you know,
well, people really are different and we should never judge by appearances?
No, we should judge by appearances. You know, at least to some extent, we shouldn't completely throw the idea away. You can sometimes judge a book by its cover, and yeah, that's a taboo notion, but, you know, we're Satanists. It kind of goes with the territory. We judge. We use labels. We're not Buddhists. We're Satanists. So anyway, the question is, like, looking from a person's physical structure and a few other traits of theirs, their hobbies, professions, and so on, can you at least get some kind of educated guess about this person and how they'd react to certain things, so that better than blind chance of getting this person to do what you want them to do or predicting what they're going to do next. And the clock system offers a way to do this with a continuum of personality types. It's not the only personality trait analyzer. I've seen others. I've bought resources on personality reading and stuff from magic stores and magic dealers and the like. Stage magicians do mentalism and cold reading and that sort of stuff. It's not the only personality trait analyzer, but I think the LaVey synthesizer clock is a great one. It's not so huge that there are these hundreds of different categories to mentally keep track of, and there are some systems like that, but it's not so small that you can't work with it, not too oversimplified either.
Now, I would probably, if I had to take a guess, put you at a 10 or 11. Would you be willing to comment on where you put yourself on the clock?
It's interesting. I think, at first I have to say, Satanists usually have a tough time placing themselves on the clock. First of all, it's hard to give an unbiased rating for yourself. That's just sort of, you know, the nature of self, you know, analysis. We all have our individual biases. And like I said, there are the people who, in extreme cases, people who oversimplify it and say, well, you know, like, what? You put me at a 9 o'clock. Well, that implies I'm social, but I hate people, so I can't be that. Or, you know, but vice versa with other parts. But it's hard also, I think, for Satanists to get a good gauge on themselves, because Satanists more often than not find a great outlet for their demonic selves.
Mm-hmm.
I think of, like, in the book, they give the example of the violin player, the 6 o'clock man violin player versus the 12 o'clock man violin player.
Yes.
So I think you have to analyze a little deeper to see what things, you know, you love are a manifestation of your, you know, demonic or your core. So it's funny that you place me at, like, a 10 or 11, because I've had people place me at the exact opposite.
I don't wonder, you know, too.
I mean the opposite from that, on the other end of the clock, so like a 3 or a 4. Actually, if you said 10, 11, that would be more 4 and 5, but, you know, I'm always open to hearing suggestions. I think, like, when I look at my body, I do seem to be more on the left hand of the clock, but the thing is, people realize, you know, I'm a lover of mathematics. I got my degrees in mathematics, and I'm a very analytical person, cold and analytical in how I deal with things professionally or when I'm writing, and that would seems put me on the right-hand side of the clock.
I was just sort of looking at sort of your comedy and your personability and...
Yeah, it's true with that. You know, I do a comedy show and that sort of fun, jovial nature stuff seems like it would lend itself to the left-hand side of the clock, definitely. But I think if you listen, this is my own analysis, and maybe I have a personal bias. Like I said, it's hard to give an own examination of yourself. But I think if you listen to me on The Devil's Mischief, it's like I'm not a zany comedy guy. I'm pretty serious. And like the paradox, as I've said, is I take my comedy very seriously. So in that sense, it's almost like my personality there is like the 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock, and some people have placed me at the 3, and my demonic self, you could say, go so far as to say, is Satan Bear, the mascot of the show, you know, who's
right,
you know, my demonic self in more ways than one. But maybe it's the other way around. Maybe I am really more of the 9-10 o'clock around there, and maybe it's my passion for mathematics and analytical is something that's fulfilling that part of me.
So give me a number.
I've had some people place me at 3, so it seems to be that way with me at 3. But again, I totally understand how a person can gauge, especially like another Satanist, as being somewhere on the clock and they may be on the opposite end. There isn't always not a definitive right answer. It's a matter of how well can you size somebody up and work with that.
So what kind of salad dressing do you order?
It's funny, when people ask this, like, online, I'm like, I'm not answering that. I read the book. I know where you're going with this.
I had to throw it in.
Honestly, I tend to switch between a couple of types. I like ranch. I do like ranch and blue cheese, but I also like sometimes the sweet honey mustard as well. So there's some parts of that that sort of place me not necessarily at the top or the bottom, I think, with that. Some would say with the blue cheese, I tend to like just creamy dressings, whether it's, you know, sweet or sour.
Go for the Italian vinaigrette. Mm. So I want to break down and discuss a chapter on ESP, extrasensual perception, a bit with you.
Sure.
I'd like to start with measuring of pupils. LaVey instructs you in The Satanic Witch on just how to read someone's pupils in a given situation. Have you found this useful, and can you think of any particular circumstances you've used it to gain a particular advantage?
I can think of a few cases, not too many. I haven't really actively used that tool. I do believe it, you know, certainly works, and there's a whole psychology backing it up. But you have to be a little careful, because sometimes, you know, that you might be in a really bright room and everybody's pupils might be contracting because of that. Sometimes also there are other more apparent clues that might give it away, where you don't have to resort to that, where some people aren't really hiding anything. Yeah, I mean, I can think of a few cases, but it hasn't been something I've actively used a lot.
Okay, let's talk about voice then. Mm-hmm. I think it applies more to ladies than men in terms of pitch and or tone. However, does the demeanor or vocabulary of your speech change based on a particular situation, or do you change it in order to gain a particular advantage? Can you think of examples?
Oh yeah, it certainly has. I think the most immediate example that comes to mind is when I get into my DJ voice. When I'm doing the announcements on The Devil's Mischief, I was told early on by some of the original DJs that, you know, when you're recording your show, you'll eventually develop and find sort of your DJ voice, where you can get into that mode. You could almost say it's ritualistic in some way. You get into that certain rhythm and enunciation and all that. And I found the DJ voice I developed to be pretty helpful in other places too. Like if I'm on stage, I host an open mic twice a week. So being able to announce events or announce people, I sort of get sort of in the same mode or talking to an audience. But also just being a lead vocalist has sort of helped me project more of my speaking voice too. I do actually have a natural tendency to mumble. So I think doing the show to DJ voices helped me a bit with that.
But when I'm sorry, go ahead.
But to give other examples, I mean, changing tones to emphasize certain points and changing vocabulary, especially depending on who you're hanging out with, you know, speaking different people's language, especially if you're dealing with somebody from a certain subculture, say.
So when you're talking to other people, you do kind of match their tenor and speed and pitch a little bit.
I do. I think there's also it depends on what sort of points you're driving home, because you can certainly change the voice to emphasize a little more dominance over others or change the tone. Certainly sarcasm has a power in how that's worded, the kind of a huge effect on how effective a, you know, remark or witty put down is. There's a lot of power in that.
Absolutely. So I know that you're very musically inclined. So you sing. Do you play any other instruments?
Yep, I've been playing bass guitar for over 25 years. And yeah, I sing in two bands. I have a 5-octave range. So my main instrument has been the voice, but I also play harmonica in the bands. I own over 40 harmonicas.
Wow.
Fun little instrument, one you can carry in your pocket, unlike a bass.
Huh, wow.
Mandolin, I play that from time to time with in bands when we do the acoustic stuff. I like the mandolin. And as I mentioned, I host the open mic nights at a coffee house where I'm singing, and I'm usually singing and playing the ukulele. In fact, I had a special selection of songs that I played for people at the 50th anniversary pre-party that we had, Church of Satan, as well as a private party we had at the Black House.
Very cool.
I was picking a lot of devil-themed songs from the early 20th century, so
that's
there
awesome.
Are a lot of them, a lot of songs about Satan from the early 1900s.
That's what I've heard. I saw a lot of posts on the forums about that. So have you ever used music to enchant someone?
I have. Whether that was, you know, picking a certain song at karaoke or doing a personal serenade. Reverend Henry Manning, I had a great talk with him at the Black House as I was playing there. And he was giving me some very interesting tips of things I hadn't even thought of before, but how even as background music, you can still find a way of controlling things in the room. Though certainly a lot to explore, something I'd certainly like to look into in the future.
This is Reverend Gene, the host of Vox Satane, exclusively on Radio Free Satan. Join me every week as we indulge in the classical side of music spanning the past 1,000 years. Vox Satane has already featured over 700 composers covering medieval, baroque, classical, romantic, and contemporary music, including chant, choral, opera, keyboard, and orchestral music, with composers ranging from Gluck to Gilmour, Bach to Bellavance, Talis to Taverner, and Paganini to Pärt. Get your weekly recommended dose of classical music on Vox Satane, only on Radio Free Satan, with me, Reverend Gene. Hail Satan!
Do satanic cults lurk in the shadows? Can memories of satanic ritual abuse be repressed? Do exorcisms really drive out demons? And are those demons always possessing Zach Bagans? I'm J.D. Sword, the Satanic Skeptic. Join me on The Devil in the Details as I examine these questions and more, bringing a skeptical and satanic perspective to the paranormal. The Devil in the Details, available on Apple Podcast, Google Podcast, Spotify, and more.
Jet Ham for us!
Jet Ham for us!
Hail Satan!
Hail Satan!
Magister Bill M. here with Satansplain. This show is available for listening in a variety of ways. You can listen to Satansplain on Spotify, YouTube, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, iTunes, Amazon Stitcher, and more. You can even listen right on the website itself, satansplain.com. But however you choose to listen to the show, please give us a like and a subscribe where available. Likewise, you can follow the show on social media like Facebook and Twitter. All of these links can be found on the main website, satansplain.com. That's really the only website you have to memorize, satansplain.com. It's quite easy. It's the name of the show with .com after it. Likewise, you can also email your comments and questions to me. bill@satansplain.com is the email address. See? My name at thenameoftheshow.com. How hard can it be? And now we return to the 2016 discussion I had on the show Dark Voices, talking about the Satanic Witch.
Let's talk about scent. LaVey warns of scrubbing away all your natural odors of seduction. Do you think this is something that only applies to women, or is this something you practice as well?
Oh, no, it's certainly something that applies to men. He does stress in the book and also in other essays as well that any scent becomes unpleasant when it's too strong. So, you know, the solution is not to never shower. There are some people who would just, you know, smell like a dumpster, and that's just repulsive. But you also don't need a, you know, you don't necessarily need a shower every day, depending on, unless maybe you work outdoors, you're at the gym a lot. But even then...
Well, he even states in The Satanic Witch that some women are attracted to, like, sweaty men.
No, they certainly are, and I think there's something to be said about the pheromones within the, you know, male body sweat as well as the female body sweat, personal scents. I've certainly had, I think a lot of us have had partners who, you know, really enamored by one's scent and, you know, wanted to keep, like, a shirt or some other article of clothing to smell when you're away.
I hear all the time in the BDSM scene about people who are attracted to their partner's armpits.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So it's a thing. LaVey states in the section on the importance of odors, if the odor that attracts us in the form of perfume or cologne, it is usually made from flowers whose odors, we mustn't forget, are intended by nature to attract for the purpose of survival and pollination. Do you wear cologne, and do you go for scents that have that certain musk that's made from the list that LaVey mentions?
I do wear some things on occasion. I have some body sprays I sometimes use. But, you know, as LaVey says, though, the original purpose of these perfumes and colognes are to mix with your own scents, not necessarily to cover things up. Some offices I've noticed have like strict policies nowadays about no perfume or cologne because some people have overdone it and bothers people in a tight enclosure. But there are some commercial ones I like, and I've had some that different girlfriends gave me, and I would wear them and later realize like the next girlfriend didn't necessarily like it. I don't think it was just because it was a cologne I got from, you know, an ex-girlfriend, but I think it just goes to show again with people having different preferences, people from different areas of the clock.
I wish that there was some kind of policy or law about people who wear too much cologne or perfume and get onto an elevator.
Oh, yeah.
Good God. The doctor also talks about some women being attracted to sweaty men. I know he briefly mentioned this before. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying you're a sweaty guy, but what's been your experience with that?
Well, I had one girlfriend who was grossed out by the idea that I don't shower every single day. But needless to say, that relationship didn't really last long anyway. And it was a long distance one too, which made even less sense. But I've certainly, I mean, with that exception, I've certainly had girlfriends who were crazy about my scent and, you know, like I said, wanted to keep like a shirt of mine or something like that or, you know, around. And also, like I said, ones who wanted to give me some kind of cologne or something to wear that they ended up liking.
There's one more quote from this section I'd like to discuss. Dr. LaVey states, the scents that you like best on yourself are inconsequential. The odors you like least are the odors the man who represents your demonic will like best. Obviously, he's speaking to women here, but have you found this to be true as well?
You know, I was recently rereading the book in sort of in preparation for this interview, and I had completely forgotten about that line, and it made me wonder if some of the things I like are really, you know, things that are more for my demonic. I had like a cool water one. I like things that are musky but also sort of sweet at the same time for myself. But, you know, again, I having read that, I now wonder if am I putting this on really because you know, I like it, or maybe the ones that I don't really like could work better in my favor.
Right.
Again, it depends on the person as well. I've noticed it's been said if you wear your father's cologne, you're just gonna smell like, you know, your father, or smell like something from, you know, decades past. But then again, there are some situations maybe you are attracting somebody who has you know, a thing in the back of the mind for a father figure and whatnot.
In the section on taste, LaVey talks about matching food and certain kinds of dishes to positions on the clock. Is this a technique you've ever used, and can you give any examples?
Well, the example that comes to mind, I don't know if it's completely related to this, but I've noticed working in different offices that you'll see people in different departments where a disproportionate number of people in those departments seem to be of like the same area of the clock. And then you'll also see that they will have, you'll see a disproportionate number of preferred tastes and things of, what they're eating and what they're drinking. Like, for example, if you have, say an office party and there are a lot of engineers there and there are a lot of like marketing people there, if you have Coke and Diet Coke to drink, if it's marketing people who are there, the Diet Coke is going to be gone first. If it's engineers, like the Coke is going to be gone first.
Interesting.
And a lot of that does come down to not just personal taste, but also I think a whole consciousness of the image and stuff. And true to the stereotype, a lot of engineers are not really health conscious at all and, looking for caffeine to go keep them up and running. A lot of 4 o'clock people just want to be, locked into doing, analyzing and doing their job.
It's absolutely true. The IT department at my work, it's Mountain Dew.
The IT department is what? Sorry.
It's a Mountain Dew.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Mountain Dew. Liquid gold, as we called that in college.
Hillbilly piss. I've also heard it called. So have you ever made any of these so-called potions run book?
I have not, but I was looking through those again, and I was thinking like, wow, I'd love to try making some of these. I've been at parties where like the vodka blush, which is not actually in the book, but it was another one of those witchy potions, has been around. In fact, we were serving some of those at the 50th party as well.
Very nice. I've always wanted to try some of those. They look like some very interesting concoctions. I've just never been up to it.
Yeah, I was a complete non-drinker my entire life up until I was about 28 or so.
Ah.
And what sold me was finally a Crown and Coke.
Crown and Coke. Yeah. Very nice. I found the section on touch to be incredibly useful as a lady in bewitching men and women in learning subtle touch and how to do it. Was there anything you gleaned from that section that was particularly useful for you?
Yeah, I can think in that book and also some other books as well. I've read about touch from other sources. And it's interesting comparing the female perspective to a male perspective, because I think you got to be careful with this, especially as a man, because the bottom line is women don't want to feel that you're a danger to them. And also, I think in my experience, people on the right-hand side of the clock tend to be more put off by touch.
Yes, absolutely.
Especially if it's done wrong, whereas if more of the touchy-feely people you meet are more on the left-hand side of the clock. And we've all seen the sort of social conflicts of the person who is touchy-feely, thinks they're being friendly, or shaking hands every single time they meet up with a person, and so the other people are sort of put off by that.
I'm a hugger.
Yeah. 4 o'clock saying that's nice. Get away from me.
Mm-hmm. I want to talk about looks. There's a section in the book called Looks Mean Everything. We're told to throw out our pantyhose for thigh highs and garters and get the 3-inch heels and the reasons why. In fact, I'm wearing a girder belt right now with my thigh highs. Since following the fashion advice in that chapter, I've noticed some tremendous results. The Satanic Warlock has not yet arrived. There's a lot of speculation there will be a chapter on fashion for men. Do you have any thoughts?
Yeah, I think it's worth maybe this is my own nitpicky vocabulary, but I think it's worth making a distinction between fashion and style, because in my mind, style is your own personal style, and fashion is really what whatever styles are deemed popular. But maybe that's just a semantics argument. In any case, I don't think men, or women for that matter, should automatically dismiss fashion and fashion magazines and the like. it's like any other like popular music or other popular trends. There may be some things that you can take and, you know, make use of for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
We know there's nothing particularly satanic about dismissing something popular based solely on the fact that it's popular.
Mm-hmm.
Some years ago, I actually wrote an article for The Trident. That was a zine put out by the Legion of Loki Grotto back when we used to print things.
Imagine zines.
That. Yes, yeah, imagine that.
I know what a zine is.
Yes. I remember, I was listening to one of your previous interviews when that was brought up. It was funny. But yeah, I wrote a little article with some suggestions for the would-be warlock. And I see a lot of men and women who buy into this myth that guys can just wear anything, which is not true, of course. I mean, it does still come down to that, you know, that rule, looks do mean everything. And I see a lot of male Satanists who go for the shaved head and goatee look or the headbanger look, and that doesn't necessarily fit them best. I see some guys who do look great with, you know, the shaved head, and others who, sorry, you look like a cancer victim.
Yeah. Right.
I think a lot of it goes back to the Satanic Bible saying, you know, the three categories are sex, sentiment, and wonder. Now, where do you honestly place yourself? Men, especially atheist men, sacrifice aesthetics for practicality too many times.
Mm-hmm.
And this, you know, getting back to the idea of what's different here with men versus women, men are pretty good at rationalizing excuses for
yes.
that. Well, it shouldn't matter to people what I wear. Well, I'm my own god, so I should be able to wear jeans and metal shirt every day. You know, I'm my own god. I shouldn't let other people dictate what I'm wearing. But again, I think men should stop and think, is this really serving you and your goals? I could spend a lot of time mentioning various things men can do and a lot of times overlook. A lot of it comes down to the fact that, like I said before, a little can go a long way. You know, try wearing shoes instead of sneakers every single day. How about that, guys? Or, you know, if you have clothes with holes in them, why not get rid of them or mend them?
Yeah, it's easy for guys to overlook these, you know, rationalize these sorts of things. Especially if they're on, you know, the 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock.
We've read about, in Satanic Witch, about people who will, on that area of the clock, will get a car and let it run until it's broken down. And it's sort of the same with clothes. And another thing I would say is
cheap clothes that fit well
will
look better than expensive clothes that do not fit well.
Yes.
It's sort of like, I guess, like to extend the cologne analogy, the same thing works for suits. Like your father's suit will look like your father's suit on you. You know, the hand-me-down looks yeah. like that. Another big thing that especially is distinguishing from men versus women is facial hair. That's a whole other issue that, you know, we can talk about.
Go ahead and talk about it.
Well, again, a lot of it comes down to some just look better shaved. Some people look really good with a beard and some people look, you know, ridiculous. I was in college in the 1990s, which was a time when everybody was sort of experimenting with different facial hair. You know, the goatee was big and people were trying all the sorts of things. I had a roommate who was trying to grow a goatee, but he was like pretty much like an albino and like 6 feet tall and skinny, so like he looked like a fucking elf, like with a goatee.
I think as far as beards are concerned, good grooming and trimming goes a long way.
Oh yeah, it does. I mean, I think a lot of guys grow a beard because they figure this is easier, I don't have to shave. It's like, well, you actually do have to shave if you want to keep it
neck beard.
Yeah, keep it well groomed. It's funny, George Carlin in one of his books Brain Droppings, which is mostly comedy, but of course he had some stuff that wasn't comedy.
That's a great book, by the way.
Oh yeah, I love it. And the introduction alone to Brain Droppings, I think, is just one of the most brilliant, his most satanic piece he ever composed. But anyway, he gave us a little quick tip about, like, here's how you actually shave a beard, and here's, you know,
go to where the crook of the neck is, where the, you know, underneath the chin, where it meets that, and shave from that area down.
Yeah. So, you know, again, it comes down to, you know, the proper grooming with that. The goatee is an interesting thing because we've sort of seen it cycle over the years where it was, you know, in earlier days, it was a real eccentric thing, especially, you know, the Mephistophelian beard or the Fu Manchu. And since that became like a popular thing in the 90s, a lot of guys who wear it now are sort of, you know, it's almost becoming the way of like the mullet.
Right.
You know, and again, it depends on the context. So some people can wear goatees and
look, you know, sinister and make that work for them.
And other people, it's, you might look at them and say, like, you know, what is this, 1995?
Some people, it just looks ridiculous.
Yeah.
Do you make it known that you're a warlock, as in the public relations for witches chapter in the Satanic Witch?
Yeah, I mean, in the Salem scene, I was billing myself as Warlock William. I had business cards and everything, you know, and as I was doing my tarot and my numerology.
Did you have to shout down a lot of white light witches?
Not as many as you'd think. There is certainly a big Wicca community and unease with, you know, with the S word stuff in that whole scene, but it's gotten a lot better. I think part of it is actually due to a friend of mine, Warlock Crowclaws, who was one of the biggest witches there, passed away a while ago, but he, I think because of his influence and some others, you know, they finally got some stores not afraid to go carry copies of the Satanic Witch or Satanic Bible, you know, to carry inverted pentagrams and the like. It was funny because one time I was, the tourists don't, I don't think they really know or care too much. Because it's funny because I was there standing with one of the witches who was head of the psychic fair, and we both had our pentagrams out. Of course, you know, my head, my sigil Baphomet, that's like point down, and his is point up. And she was saying, so why is one like point up and one point down? And I give the standard answer without mentioning the S word, saying like, well, as you know, point down, people associate with more of a grounding and physical materials of attraction, and others point up with a more spiritual blah, blah, blah. And she was saying,
now, this guy who has the point one, the one that's pointing up, that looks like more evil to me than the one that's pointing down.
Actually,
so go figure.
I have a coworker at work that's Wiccan, and she wears her pentagram point up to work every day, and I wear my sigil Baphomet to work every day. Mm-hmm. And we work, her office is right next to my desk, so we're like right next to each other.
Starlane.
Right? Where would you rate the Satanic Witch in terms of importance of satanic literature in comparison to the other books?
I'd say more important than people give it credit for. It's hard to rate it to all the others exactly because it becomes like an apples versus oranges deal pretty fast. You know, like
the Satanic Rituals is all about greater magic,
whereas Satanic Witch is about lesser magic, despite a few ceremonial things near the end. So I'd say it's at least, it is the one that I think way too often gets dismissed out of the five books that LaVey wrote, for sure.
So for the books that people need to read, Satanic Bible, Satanic Rituals, and then the Satanic Witch?
Well, it depends. I mean, the way I see it is the Satanic Bible is obviously the bedrock, and it talks about greater magic and lesser magic, among many other things.
And the Satanic Witch is sort of the expansion of the topic of lesser magic, whereas Satanic Rituals is the expansion of greater magic.
Okay, that's fair enough for me. The Satanic Witch has been accused of being miSoGynistic. What's your response to that?
I just find that like ridiculous because the book is written for women to specifically help with personal gain. So I don't see what's anti-woman about that. It's, you know, empowerment, specifically women for personal empowerment. But the people who call it miSoGynistic are invariably women who, you know, sternly equate exploiting femininity with submitting to the demands of horny men, the male patriarchy, or running counter to modern feminism and women's lib. And feminists like that seem to be the women who don't really have any accomplishments of their own, and they need feminism and protesting as an identity, or think that the
key to success for women is to behave like men,
or to even sometimes have
men behave more effeminate.
The beginning of the book explains that, you know, looks are everything, whether you like it or not, and it makes it very clear that
it's not necessarily good looks as in a stereotypical beauty that you need,
though that certainly doesn't hurt. But, you know, there are other traits and images of the female form that you as a witch can exploit and use.
Exactly. That's perfectly well stated. A lot of men think that the Satanic Witch is written for women and can just skip it and wait for the Satanic Warlock What are your thoughts on that? And what do you think that the Satanic Warlock may include that the Satanic Witch didn't?
Well, I'm really hoping that the first lines of the Satanic Warlock say,
if you're a man who's dismissed the Satanic Witch and just waited until this book was written, well, you're an idiot.
Go read the Satanic Witch first. Because really, there's so much in there that men can use. And I've been at gatherings with Satanists where I see some women try to apply some of the things from the book, but I catch them doing it. And, you know, I would think that this was brought up, I know, in one of the other interviews, like, as a man, wouldn't you be interested in learning what some of these tricks are that people might be trying to pull on you? Or people will go to a Satanism forum and ask, you know, like I said, like, they'll ask what their favorite salad dressing is, and I'll say, no, you don't, I read the book too. But I'm hoping the Satanic Warlock doesn't include the bullshit reverse macho claims that we hear, like, you know, you have to know that women are truly the dominant and superior of the two sexes, and you're a man and men are stupid, or you always have to treat women with respect, because both of those sentiments are, you know, BS. I learned that early in life. Your chromosomes at birth don't determine your superiority in this life, and respect comes down to whether an individual has earned it. But I don't expect that stuff to be in the Satanic Warlock. I don't, because when I first heard the Satanic Warlock was coming out, I was like, oh, this is kind of stupid if people not read, you know, the Satanic Witch. And then I read that it was being written by Magister Bob Johnson. I was like, oh, okay then, well, yeah, this I can look forward to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I trust him because I know he knows what he's talking about.
I had the same reaction. I was like, yeah. Wait, why do we need this book? And then I saw who it was being written by, and I was like, oh, okay, I want to read it.
Yeah, exactly. I did actually have a chat with Magister Johnson about the book about a year ago. We were sharing a cab ride, and he revealed a couple of things which should prove to be interesting. I'm not going to divulge the details. But yeah, certainly some interesting takes there. I would think that since the Satanic Witch is built on the premise of, you know, you are a woman and therefore you're different and you should exploit your difference. I would think that since that's the case, I suspect the Satanic Warlock would take that kind of similar approach to being a man. That as a man, you are different from a woman. So what are the sort of advantages that you can take as a man and, you know, exploit to your advantage?
Excellent. That's all the questions I had. I thank you for joining me again on Dark Voices.
Well, sure. Thank you for having me.
Hail Satan.
Hail Satan.
All right. That's going to do it for this episode of Dark Voices. I really hope you enjoyed my interview with Bill M. as much as I did. I hope you learned a lot. I found the interview to be very educational. If you haven't read The Satanic Witch or you haven't purchased it, please go out and buy it and read it. There's a lot to be learned, and one cannot master lesser magic without reading The Satanic Witch. Even if you're a man, The Satanic Witch needs to be read. If you've learned nothing from my 4 episodes on The Satanic Witch, it is you should go out and read it.
You have been listening to Satansplain. If you have enjoyed this episode, please give it a like and subscribe where available. For more information on the show, visit satansplain.com. And to learn more about Satanism itself, visit churchofsatan.com. This episode, copyright 2022, Magister Bill M.